I think it's important to start by saying that I and Socialist Alternative collectively send huge sympathies and solidarity to everyone who knew and is mourning Sarah Everard, and also to those many thousands of people in the local community in South London, but also across the country, who may not have known her, but have felt a very deep trauma and sadness over her death. And I think we have to ask, why has this case struck such a chord? Why has it been felt so deeply by so many people, and especially by women? And I think a big part of the answer to that lies in the now infamous survey released recently by UN Women UK, which showed that 80% of all women and 97% of younger women have experienced sexual harassment. And that figure is shocking, and it has shocked and angered many people. I think particularly men who may have been more surprised by it. Because I think maybe for most women, our initial reaction was, who are those 3%? Maybe they had misunderstood the question. Because we know that this is our everyday experience. We know it happens to us, to our friends, our sisters, our co-workers. It happens on public transport, it happens on the street, in school, and in the workplace. And we live every moment of our lives taking it into account. Without a second thought, we plan different routes home, we make fake phone calls, we hold our keys between our knuckles, and so many other things that we shouldn't have to do. And we do those things not just to avoid the harassment itself. Harassment is intimidating because there is always the back of the thought in our minds of the possibility of that escalating beyond just words. But we know that the misogynistic attitudes that sexual harassment expresses are also the root of physical and sexual violence against women. And that is not paranoia. It's based on the very real fact that violence against women is endemic in our society, that one in three women will experience violence at some point in her lifetime. And it's those points that have led to such an outpouring of anger being sparked by Sarah's murder and by the reaction to it, especially by the victim blaming of the police in response to Sarah's murder, of telling local people, local women, that they shouldn't go out alone, which is especially galling given that the man who has been charged with her murder was a serving police officer. It's the fact that so many thousands of women's immediate response was, that could have been me, that led them to take to the streets to express their upset and also their anger. I attended the vigil in Clapham on Saturday, and it was a very powerful event to be part of. It was very emotional, for much of the time very quiet, but very determined that we were not going to be prevented from making the stand that was necessary. And it was also, to begin with, very socially distanced and very peaceful. And as we have all either experienced firsthand or seen in the press and social media coverage since, that changed with the intervention of the Met Police. Because after about an hour of the vigil taking place, they decided to shut it down, began removing speakers from the platform and trying to disperse the crowd. And the situation escalated entirely by the police, led to a situation where young women protesters were pinned to the ground, intimidated, and arrested by male police officers on a protest against intimidation and violence against women. It was a totally outrageous attack by the Met Police, and far from the first time that type of approach has been exhibited by that institution. So it's unsurprising then that since then there have been very widespread calls for Cressida Dick, the Met Police Chief, to stand down over that incident, which she absolutely should be forced to do. But we have to be clear that getting rid of a few bad apples, or even getting rid of one bad chief apple, isn't the issue here. And thinking about it in those individual terms can actually lead you to some quite problematic positions. So, for example, one of the original organisers of the Clapham vigil, the one that was called off because of not having police permission, has been quoted in the press as saying that Dick should not resign on the basis that we are a movement of women seeking to support and empower other women, and as one of the most senior women in British policing history, we do not want to add to the pile-on. And that is a really big mistake, because surely the whole experience shows that having women in senior positions does not change the way that institutions behave towards women more widely. And Cressida Dick, by the way, also wrote to Priti Patel after the Extinction Rebellion protests in 2019, saying that there should be further restrictions on protests. So I think it's very clear what her position is on the type of measures that the government is now trying to implement through its bill. Other useless ideas that have been raised by the police and the government since Sarah's murder include the quite laughable suggestions of more police on the streets and also sending police patrols into nightclubs, supposedly to protect women. And I think it's very clear that women, especially after what we've witnessed from the police in the last week, are not going to be comforted by that. In fact, what would it actually mean if those measures were implemented? It would mean a clampdown on democratic rights, as we've seen. And it would especially mean an increase in police harassment of black and minority ethnic people. Why is it that more police makes us less safe? What is the role of the police in society? I think these are the questions that many people are currently asking themselves. Under capitalism, the most central role of the police as an institution is to defend the interests of the system and to protect the property of the super rich. The police is a mechanism through which the capitalist state can maintain control over the population. And we've seen that throughout history, when the police have been used against all different kinds of groups organising to improve their conditions and to resist oppression. When the police have attacked workers on strike, people marching against racism, sexism, homophobia, people protesting against climate change, and many other examples. And reactionary ideas are embedded in the very bones of the police, in policing practices, in the wider justice system through racist laws, courts, the lack of representation of minorities in all those institutions and in other ways as well. And it's therefore totally expected that you do find elevated levels of all forms of prejudice amongst police officers as well. So we have to oppose any increase in police powers to attack people and their rights, most immediately standing full scale against the attempts to implement the Police and Crime Bill, which will give police chiefs essentially the right to decide when, where and how we protest, and to issue draconian fines and prison sentences for breaking those rules. And I think it's really important, the resistance that we've seen to that bill, which could be the beginnings of a real movement to defend and extend our right to protest. But we also at the same time have to escalate the movement against violence against women and against all forms of sexism. I think Sarah's murder has lifted the lid on an anger that has been bubbling under the surface of society for many years. And it's not only in Britain that that has been a feature. In fact, up until this point, we've maybe in this country seen fewer movements and protests than there have been on these issues of women's oppression than has generally been the case on a world scale. And we should see this wave of current protests absolutely as standing alongside the Me Too movement, which expressed abuse and harassment amongst the rich and powerful, but also gave millions of women the opportunity to share their own experiences of those things. Standing alongside Niuna Menos, which means not one less, a huge wave of movements across Latin America against femicide. Standing alongside the movement in Poland resisting attacks on the right to abortion, the movements in Ireland and Argentina, which won improvements in the right to abortion in those countries. Standing alongside the mass protests against rape in India, alongside the protests that have been taking place in the last couple of weeks in Australia against sexual violence. And that growth of a global women's movement is the result of partly of the coming to power of the populist right, misogynists like Trump and Bolsonaro. It partly reflects the disproportionate impact of the last economic crisis of 2007, 2008 on women. But most importantly, maybe, it reflects the exposure of a lie that we were sold in a previous period. The message that equality had been achieved, not just on gender equality, but race and sexuality as well. That the capitalist class and politicians adopted the flags of those struggles as their own, claiming that they were in support of those movements, that they'd implemented laws that meant that movements were no longer necessary. And partly as a result of that, and partly because of the movements that won changes, ideas, especially amongst young people, have completely changed in the last 20, 30 years. But the conditions that we face in our everyday lives haven't changed to meet those expectations. All forms of oppression remain absolutely rife in our daily experience. And while we haven't seen so many big protests on the streets in Britain until now, that shift in ideas has absolutely been reflected here. There's been a transformation over the last decade of the understanding, particularly amongst young people, of what attitudes and behaviours are acceptable. A real feeling of not being willing to accept the ways that things have previously been done. A desire to be fully inclusive, to speak about and take up the specific issues facing trans women, women of colour, and disabled women. And an instinctive internationalism. So everywhere that these protests have taken place, women are watching what happens elsewhere, and there have been important solidarity protests, for example, with the movement in Poland that have taken place in Britain in recent years. We've seen that this increased desire to challenge and organise against all forms of oppression, for example, in the Black Lives Matter protests that took place last summer, which really had a huge impact on the conversations being had in communities across the country, particularly, for example, on issues like the blood-soaked history of British imperialism. We saw it just 10 days or so ago in the huge response to the Oprah interview with Meghan Markle. And I think that response reflected not so much a personal support for Meghan Markle as an individual, but an understanding, a shared experience that millions of people felt with the racism, sexism and mental health struggles that she described in that interview. And at the same time, there are a whole host of other issues impacting women in particular, and especially in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic. Domestic abuse has skyrocketed, with many women trapped in homes with their abusers. There was a recent study showing that young women and girls have spent less time on education and more time on household chores compared to young men during the lockdowns, a sign that prescribed gender roles still remain a major factor in our lives. Women have been more likely to lose their jobs, mainly because of the sectors of the economy that have been particularly impacted by the lockdowns, retail and hospitality, for example. They've done a bigger share of the increased childcare and homeschooling, reporting suffering an increase in anxiety and depression, partly as a result of that. And it's important to say that in the main, women suffering disproportionately as a result of the lockdowns and the pandemic isn't because people have made a conscious decision that women should pay a greater price. Instead, it's a firm reminder that women were already in a more vulnerable position before COVID, that equality has very much not been achieved. So why is that? Where do sexist attitudes and behaviours come from? As socialists, we would say that capitalism conditions people to see women as subordinate to men. And that's useful to the system in many ways. It's useful to be able to justify paying women less in the workplace, to be able to use them as free labour in the home. But it can also explicitly make money through the objectification and commodification of women's bodies and sexuality, the porn industry, sexist advertising, and so on. And all of those factors majorly distort the relationships between people, the way we see ourselves and see each other. There's nothing natural about unequal pay. There's nothing natural about rigid gender roles, or indeed about male violence against women. But the makeup of capitalist society breeds those things, and in fact needs them to survive. It's also, as a result, the system is inherently hostile to individuals whose identity challenges in any ways those dominant ideas, those strict gender roles, and the nuclear family that kind of infers, meaning breeding homophobia and transphobia at the same time. So we absolutely have to fight for all and any measures that can make women feel more safe as we go about our lives, and also that could make us feel more confident to report harassment and abuse. And that includes, for example, fighting to reverse cuts, like the huge cuts that have been made to street lighting in many communities, calling for investment in things like free emergency phones on the street, free rape alarms, self-defence classes and measures like those. It also includes demanding an open and democratic inquiry into the murder of Sarah Everard and also into the unsolved murders of other women, such as Blessing Olusegun, and that those inquiries should include elected representatives from those women's families, communities, campaign groups, trade unions and other relevant organisations. It also means fighting for all special training, resources and measures that can assist survivors of gender violence to take their cases to court and to deal with the aftermath those attacks. We should also fight for a full and fact-based programme of sex and relationships education to take place in all schools, and for that to include issues like consent, sexist bullying, tackling victim blaming and rape myths. And we have to really fight for the trade unions to take up these issues boldly and campaign for the changes that are needed in the workplace, including to tackle sexual harassment in the workplace. But also the issues affecting wider society, to be part of those campaigns. And in the process of showing a lead on those issues, to educate their own members as well. Yes to all of those fights, all of those measures, and we can win big change. There are many things that in the past were considered acceptable, which are no longer considered acceptable, and they are, in general, the result of movements of women and of workers which have won those changes in material conditions and in attitudes. But at the same time, we have to say that even if we won campaigns on all of those issues, women would not be safe. Not safe on the streets and not safe at home. Because, of course, it's still the case that the vast majority of violence against women and children occurs within the home or by someone they know. And we have to raise the stories of all women who suffer abuse and harassment and make clear that this isn't an individual issue to be solved by individuals changing their behaviour. Instead, it's a societal issue which needs a mass, united, collective response from working class and young people and women. A united response means highlighting the particular violence and discrimination faced by trans women. The fact that black women can't trust the police, both as women and as black people. The fact that the poorest women have the hardest time speaking out and getting out of violent situations. A united movement also means involving people of all genders in the fight against violence against women, because it's together that we can fight for the system change that is needed. As I've described, capitalism breeds and needs violence against women. Misogynistic culture, attitudes and behaviours can only be eradicated when capitalism is eradicated. A socialist society where the majority would democratically own and control the resources and ways of producing wealth in society and plan those resources to meet the needs and wants of the majority rather than the obscene profits of the tiny few. On that kind of basis, the basis of that type of society, it would be possible to begin to really erode all forms of oppression, violence and prejudice, and for people to live genuinely, safely and freely.